the blessings of God even in difficult times. Seeing the blessings of God even in difficult times. Does anybody have a pair of sunglasses with them? Sunglasses. Okay. Can you put them on? You know, there's something weird about someone who will wear sunglasses inside a building. It doesn't make sense, does it? Does it make sense for her to wear sunglasses when it's not that bright in here? Usually you wear sunglasses in the right environment. What happens, though, in our Christian life, thank you, is that Satan would like to put sunglasses on you spiritually. The Bible says that he would like to darken the minds of them, lest the light of the glorious gospel should shine unto them. The fact is that Satan would like to take even circumstances in our life, even difficulties in our life, and he would like for that to be kind of like sunglasses on, where you are constantly viewing your entire life, every circumstance, every event, every moment of your life, as if you have sunglasses on. In other words, everything in your life, it's always dark. Nothing's ever bright. Nothing's ever clear. Nothing's ever right. Everything seems to go wrong. It just seems like it kind of compiles one thing after another. And by the way, I do not believe that God is the one who desires that for our life. I believe difficult times happen in people's life because we lived in a sin-cursed world. The Bible says that Satan is the god of this world, little g. He is the god. He is the prince of the power in the air. Listen, folks, bad things happen because we live on a sin-cursed world. But how do you know that as a Christian, this is the worst it will ever get for us, that someday heaven is where we'll be and everything will be made right? I thank God for that. But you live in Satan's domain, if you will. Ever since the Garden of Eden, when Adam and Eve decided that they were going to disobey God and do their own thing, it was at that moment, in a perfect environment, that they were cast out of Eden. They were in a perfect environment, a sinless environment. And the Bible says that the fellowship that God had with Adam and Eve was broken. Adam and Eve had constant, intimate fellowship with God every moment physically with God. Can you imagine that? God would just show up and would walk with them and talk with them. Whether in bodily form or spirit form, we're not really sure. But the point is that after their sin, the Bible says that they were cursed. Mankind was cursed. The ground was cursed. And they were cast out. And the fact is, God even put angels at the Garden of Eden to keep them out. From that moment on, Satan has tried his best to darken the minds of every person, and even believers who have once and do walk with God, to keep this veil over our eyes to think that God isn't for us. Here in Acts chapter 18, I think is a remarkable passage that helps us see blessings even in difficult times. There isn't a week that goes by that I'm probably not confronted with or told about or included in or told alluded to some type of or informed about some type of situation that's just bad. It doesn't matter if that person is saved or unsaved. And most time it's with people who are saved. And they tell about something that's kind of gone wrong. And here's what they're wanting. What do I do? Why is this thing happening? Why is this so bad for me? How come this hasn't worked out? And I want you to know that even in this situation here in Acts chapter 18, what you find is you find the Apostle Paul on the verge of things that were happening that were incredible, that were awesome, that were glorious, souls being saved. Even in the midst of that, difficulties hit his life. But through, as you heard before, even in the clouds, that you've heard this say, every cloud has a silver lining. Now, I don't know if that's biblical, all right? I don't know, but I'd rather say it this way. I must choose to see or not see the blessings, even in difficult or bad times. And by the way, I believe there are blessings, even in difficult times. And I'm going to give you an illustration in just a moment, but often here's what happens in the lives of Christians. We devote our lives to big events or seasons in our life to kind of get us to refocus on what really matters. I'll give you, for instance, a big fat one. Easter is coming. Easter is our glorious banner. It is our theme. It is the flag that we raise the highest. It is the cross of Calvary that changed our life. We live and love the cross of Jesus Christ. We know he's not on the cross. We know better yet, he's not even in the tomb. He is risen. But in order to get to the tomb, you got to back up and get to the cross, because Christ paid the ultimate price for the sins of mankind on the cross. So for Easter, it's our big celebration. Can I ask you something? How come we emphasize April 16th over every Sunday? Shouldn't every day of your life be an Easter Sunday? How about a big fat, for instance, like Christmas? Christmas is the birth of Jesus Christ. Christ has come. He came in the form of a baby, born of a virgin. You need to find him lying in a manger. Hey, how come we don't celebrate his birth every day? How come we wait till Christmas? You know what we do at Christmas? We buy gifts. We buy gifts for people that we don't even talk to all year long, or maybe even see, but we'll buy them a gift. Or maybe it's a coworker and you do those gad gifts, or what they call a white elephant, and you exchange gifts. You know what? Our mentality is all wrong, isn't it? I'll give you another big fat, for instance. How about Thanksgiving? Now listen, folks, I'd like to have turkey and ham all during the week, not just on Thanksgiving. You know what I mean? I like turkey and ham. I like those all during the year. But there are certain items I don't get, or that I don't even have a tendency to focus on except at Thanksgiving. I don't believe, and I could be wrong. If Melissa was in here, she could correct me. But I don't believe I eat stuffing any time of the year except at Thanksgiving. Now, Miss Birdie, that's just wrong. We ought to have some stuffing during the year, amen. And cranberry sauce. And I don't even give a rip if it's shaped in the form of a can and have little ripples around it. I don't care. I just, you know, they plop it in a dish with a ripple still on it. And I'm like, you know, the least you can do is break it up so it looks like you made it. I mean, it still has the indentions of the can on there. I mean, that, to me, it just reminds me of dog food. I mean, you know, that's the way you plop out dog food. You know what I mean? My point is this. How come we can go in our life, and we're all guilty of it, Christian, how can we go all year long and not thank the Lord for his blessings except come November? How come our services aren't more of a, hey, I just want to remind you how good God is and encourage you so you can see some good things? You know, a lot of times we expect the pulpit to be instructional, and it is, where we're taught some things, but sometimes you come to the Bible because you just come for encouragement. You know, the Bible says this. Keep a bookmarker in Acts 18. That'll be our text. I want you to look at Ephesians 5:20. Would you do that? Ephesians 5:20. Let's look at that together. Hey, camera guys, is the light setting all right? Is this bad? It's a little bright. Well, I know I look like I had a fight with a tomato and lost. I know that. But I'm not talking about that. We're adjusting some things. We might be working some things out. And I wanted to make sure, and I know it's during the message time, but it's not like we come in here and practice lights, all right? Look at Ephesians 5:20, and notice this. Paul's the writer of this, and notice in verse 20 he says, give thanks. Notice this. What's that third word, giving thanks? What is it? Now, you know that didn't just creep in your Bible overnight. It didn't creep in there 5 minutes ago. You know that's always been there, right? Giving thanks, when? Now here's the thing. For all things, always means, don't say always, I can read that word. Thank you. Someone said it, all the time. Now, is your life good all the time, yes or no? This book, though, said give thanks always. Now, here's the thing, for all things. Now, all things aren't good, Miss Birdie. Notice this. We'll get back to the Bible. Ephesians 5:20, giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And by the way, we've been praying and studying on prayer on Wednesday nights for now. And man, I'm going to tell you, if you need some encouragement and growth in your prayer life, you ought to be coming on Wednesday night. Now, I'm even going to talk about that phrase. Why does the Bible, someone said, well, you know, if you don't pray in Jesus' name, if you don't say those words, God doesn't hear you. Well, I want you to know, number one, that's a lie. And that's not what the Bible says. And there's a reason why the Bible says this, but it doesn't say that if you don't say this, and you specifically don't say this, that God doesn't hear you. And I'm going to cover some of those topics, as well as some others in our prayer life, just helping us grow and keep the Bible in the right context. But here's the thing. Sometimes we become thankful, or we only see the blessings when things are good. Do you know that when you read your Bible, maybe you have and maybe you haven't read it all the way through, you know what I have found and run into most of the time? There's a lot of problems in this book. People had a lot of issues. I mean, time and time again, you found issues, problems. But I think for a Christian, having a heart of thankfulness, a heart of just desiring to see the good, even in the bad times, should be intricately woven into the fabric of our life. Why? Because if anyone ought to be thankful, it ought to be the Christian. If anyone has anything to be thankful for, it's you and me. Like I said, if I got nothing but the cross, if I got nothing but the cross of Christ, I've received His grace and I've gotten more, like I said this morning, than I deserve. See, pride will get you to the point that you think you deserve better than what you got. But praise says, I've gotten better than I deserve. See, that's the difference between praise and pride. Praise says, hey, man, I got the best deal. I got better than I deserve. Well, pride will say, you know what? I should get a little bit better. I got a raw deal. Can I ask you tonight, are you breathing tonight? Are you breathing? Some of us aren't breathing as good. You know, the worst thing about being stopped up and having sinuses is that you can't sleep. Can't sleep good. That's the worst thing. I hate that. Or you wake up like you're choking. You ever do that? Just fall asleep and all of a sudden act like you're about to choke. But you know what? I'm still breathing. Shouldn't you thank God for your breathing right now? Even if it's labored. How about this? How many of you, just by show of hands, and even if they're false teeth, I hope you cleaned them, you were able to brush your teeth today. Amen? Listen to me. How simple and silly is that? But you know, there are some people who can't even brush their own teeth. Man, aren't we rotten in here? We're just rotten. When's the last time you thought about that someone would have to feed you? I got a man who came to me while we're playing basketball, he's been coming for a while. He says, you know, I just want to tell you how much I appreciate your church doing this and spending time with us and giving us a little bit of Bible along the way. And listen, he said, can my son comes with him every now and then. I didn't know this. He said, do you have something here to eat? He says, do you have a snack machine? I said, Lord, no. I said, that's all we need around here is a snack machine. I said, well, that's all we do around here is snack. And I said, I think that'd be a nightmare to keep up with and then probably end up being broken into. And long story short, I said, why? He says, well, my son needs something to eat. And I said, well, man, that's no problem. Then he began to tell me. He says, you know, my son has a feeding tube. I said, what? He said, yeah. He said, my son can't really eat anything or digest. And he gave this long name, and I don't know what it is. But boy, I listened intently when he said my son, because I thought about my kids. He says, you know, he says he doesn't eat much when he does eat because he can't digest anything, and it really messes with his intestines. And he says, so we have to, at night, put him on this food. He said, it's kind of like Ensure that runs in him, and we do it at night. He says, but anytime our kid asks for anything to eat, you know, he says, we don't care if it's a pizza in the middle of night. You know what we go and do? He says, we go get a pizza. You know, I thought about this message, how thankful I should be that I can feed myself. How thankful I should be that I'm not having to feed my children. And I thought about this guy, just a sweet little boy. That little boy came up to me and said, thank you for the potato chips. I said, son, and it was one of the student ministry potato chips, I owe you one. They sometimes wonder where their food goes. It's probably those guys. And I said, you know what? Anytime. He can have anything we have here. When that boy's ready to eat and can't eat, you let him eat. That's a blessing. You know what I'm saying? Because that boy wants to eat. Because he normally never eats and they have to feed him through a tube. You know what? How about taking a bath? Amen. Isn't it good to take a bath? Clean it up? Man, I thank God for that. I thank God that I'm not having, you ever been to a pool and there's them chairs that you have to get in, they have to lure people in and ride them out? Man, thank God I can get in and get out. Some people can't do that. See, what are you saying? I'm just saying that a lot of times we overlook even the smallest things because we're walking around with sunglasses on instead of allowing to see the blessings in our life. I want to say that sometimes being thankful and seeing the blessings can be a challenge. When you're going through a difficult trial or problem, it's easy to lose sight of what God's doing. It's easy to focus on the darkness. It's easy to focus on the negative. And by the way, that's exactly what Satan wants you to do. Loved one, listen to me. I believe that there is a demonic oppression of depression in the Christian's life. I believe it's demonic. I believe the Bible teaches against demonic possession of believers. I do not believe the Scripture teaches anything other than when a person's life is changed, their spirit is made alive, and there's nothing that Satan can do about that. I believe you're eternally secure in Christ, and Christ is in the Father. But I do believe that Satan attacks believers through oppression. The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 5:18, in everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Listen to me now. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Listen to me. You want to be right with God? You want to live the will of God out in your life? Start being thankful. Start seeing the blessings, even in difficult or bad times. I know it's not always easy. I know it's sometimes hard. I know it's difficult to walk the path. But God says in everything, give thanks. In everything. Good and bad times. In the midst of difficult times, we can see the blessings if we choose to. There is a commentator, that maybe many of you have in your library. I have everything he's got. His name is Matthew Henry. I have Matthew Henry's commentary. I don't look at those or rely on them like I once did in years past. But I still have his commentary. He has commentated on every book of the Bible. Matthew Henry. Matthew Henry was walking down a corridor one night and was robbed. Being who he was, it kind of got a little bit of attention, and they asked him what he thought about him being robbed. And I'm going to share with you what he wrote. He says, you know, I was robbed, and he says, but I want to obey the Bible. And I want to give thanks in all things. He said, and so when I got robbed, I thank God that I didn't have much on me to be robbed of. He says, when I got robbed, listen to me, I want to thank God that what I had on me was very little when normally I carry a lot. He says, I want to thank God that when I got robbed, that although they took my money, they didn't take my life. He said, and I want to lastly thank God that when I got robbed, that I was the one being robbed instead of the one doing the robbing. Wow. Come on. That's amazing. Are we serious? But when I read that and that was put in perspective, man, I thank God to know that. But how can a man who got robbed have that kind of attitude? Oh, he probably just said that because someone asked. No, I believe it's because that man understood the Bible. And although he may have commentated on the books of the Bible, I believe that God's word got in his heart. And I believe it worked on him. And that when those difficult times came like that, he literally lived what he believed. Here in our text in Acts chapter 18, would you go back there? I really set the backdrop for this last time, but obviously you know he's traveling from one city to another. He's leaving Athens and going to Corinth. This is a city that was known for its wickedness. And yet the Apostle Paul is coming to it, going to bring the gospel here. A city that was known for its lasciviousness. It was known for its pagan religion. It was known for its sexual sin that was embedded in its culture. They worshiped the goddess of love called Aphrodite. And Paul's going right into this. It was a metropolitan city. Paul was entering what we believe is the cesspool of sin. It was immorality all over. It was degradation. Yet Paul knew and understood that there was the power of God that would lead to salvation. And it could radically change those people that even had the vilest of hearts. Yet what we find is that when Paul arrives in Corinth, it wasn't easy. There was opposition. We find that with the opposition, there's no doubt that it appears from the text, as Paul entered into this city, that people mocked him, that he was broke. That means have no money, folks. Had no funds. And that when he shared Christ, people outright blasphemed him and blasphemed Christ. And the fact is, we also find that his life was in jeopardy and the people wanted to kill him. Now, I would think that if you're going to do God's work, you'd think that there'd be a little bit better reception. But that's not what took place. And here in our text is something amazing, and I'd like for you to look at verses 1 and 2 again. The Bible says in Acts chapter 8, verses 1 and 2, after these things, Paul departed from Athens and came to Corinth, just told you that. And notice what he encountered, what he found, what God put in his life, and found a certain Jew named Aquila, that's the husband, born in Pontus, lately came from Italy with his wife Priscilla, Aquila and Priscilla, because that Claudius hath commanded all the Jews to depart from Rome and came unto them. And so he gets here, and look at verse 3, and because he was of the same craft, that means they did the same thing. They had the same lifestyle. They had the same job. They had the same career, we know, is tent making. He abode with them, look at the end of the verse, and wrought, for by their occupation, they were tent makers. So the Bible defines this. And here's what I want you to remember. That even in difficult times, in the opposition that Paul encountered, I want to remind you what I said last time, is that there are blessings even in bad times. And one of the blessings that I see here within the first few verses is we can see the blessings for our needs being provided. Paul had no money, but he could do some stuff, so God put some people in his life where he can make some money. He could have his needs met. When Paul arrived here, they gave Paul a job. And the matter of fact is, not just they gave him a job, he abode there. The Bible says in verse 3, he abode with them. Not only did they give him a job, they gave him a place to live. So here he comes into the city. He doesn't know these people. God puts him in them in his path, gives them a job so he could meet his needs, but also puts a roof over his head. God has graciously provided for all our spiritual needs, yes, by places us in Christ. Man, I thank God for that. But materially, Paul had told Timothy that if we had food and clothing and shelter, we should be content. That's what he told Paul in 1 Timothy 6, 7 and 8. Remember, we talked about having a blessing on Sunday morning, being blessed to be a blessing to others. But a lot of times, we can't be a blessing to others because we're not content with the stuff that God gives us. So we have to go out and spend more because we want to consume it all on for ourselves. But Paul reminds us, listen, I'm going to be content. And God provided food, clothing, and raiment. He provided for his basic needs. I'm going to tell you something. That's a blessing. That's a blessing for your needs to be met. And I'm looking at all of you, and I'm going to be wrong with you. I think the stats are wrong. And I'm not saying it's conspiracy or any of that thing. I'm just saying to you that it's very hard to find, listen to me, starving people in America. You might find some hungry people, but starving? No. They may go a few meals, and by the way, we all could go a few meals without something. But to go without eating for an indefinite period of time? If that happens, it's very rare. But Paul said, listen, how come we're not just happy with getting our bellies filled? How come we're not just happy with the clothes that we have in our closet currently? Now, I know if they wear out, you got to replace them. But how come we're not content with where we live? Paul says, if you got those things, how come you just can't be satisfied? Kind of reminds me of a pastor who came across. He was known for helping homeless people. The pastor came across a homeless couple, and it was obvious that this couple, this man and wife, were in desperate need of food. And they came to the pastor and said, Pastor, we need some food. And we don't want you to give us money. We're not asking you to even put us up for the night. We're not asking for clothes. And listen, we know how the whole thing works. We just want to be honest with you. We are hungry. Can you help us? And so the man quickly got the couple together, and he went to the nearest place, and all God's people love 7-Eleven. Amen. And so he took them to a 7-Eleven. And obviously, you can probably get much of anything. You can get even the dogs that roll on the rollers all day long. Amen. You can get one of those things. And so he sat them out front and said, "Listen, I'm going to go in, and man, I'm going to go get what you need." He said, "I'm going to feed your bellies." And so he started bringing stuff out, and man, they were eating it as fast as he was bringing it. He says he knew they were hungry. He just didn't realize it was that bad. And he was so intent in helping these people, and he forgot about getting something to drink. And they looked at it and said, "Well, can we have something to drink?" I mean, that's natural. Nothing wrong with that. And he says, "You know what? I didn't think about that." And so he goes in the store and comes right back out. The man opens the drink and downs it and spits it out and goes, "Are you kidding me? This is diet." Isn't that silly? We can complain and gripe about the smallest stuff. Now, I don't even know if that story is true. I don't know if that really happened, but I think I can identify with it sometimes. How we can get so dissatisfied in the church chairs that we sit in and never see the blessings of God in difficult times. May we be obedient and become thankful. No matter how difficult times may get, if we have food, clothes, roof, I think we all can lift up our heads and thank God, can't we? I'll tell you another thing that I see here. I'd like for you to look at verse 4. "And he reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath and persuaded the Jews and the Greeks." Here he lands. He gets to meet this couple. He gets to have a home. He gets to use his handiwork, his craftsmanship, his skill, if you will, to make tents, to put money in his pocket. But I'm going to tell you, it didn't come without opposition. "And he reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath and persuaded the Jews and the Greeks." You know what I find here is that you really do not see where, as he is reasoning with them, you don't find any record of people's lives being changed. You don't find that souls are saved right here. Now, we know the Apostle Paul was very zealous, and we know he's very eager, and he was very passionate about the ministry that God had given in him. And here he is fulfilling that. But he's in there preaching and teaching, and you find no encouragement. Here's a blessing I think we see, not only that God provides for our needs in difficult times, but another blessing is that God will provide friends to encourage you along the way. Say, what do you mean, encourage you? Yeah. Well, ever since Paul arrived at Athens, I believe he walked a difficult road. The scripture teaches that. And the people of Athens were totally complacent to the gospel. And Corinth was given over to immorality. And Paul here is preaching and teaching. And if you remember, we left where Paul and Silas were in jail, and they were freed. And now Silas and Timothy are no longer in the picture at this moment. And he goes into this alone. And he had no human companion to help him and sustain him. And I am sure that he was lonely and probably a bit discouraged along the way. But Aquila and Priscilla were there. Can you imagine you staying up late at night with the Apostle Paul? Can you imagine staying up after the 11 o'clock news and Paul says, "Hey, have I ever told you how I got saved?" Ever told you about what happened on the road to Damascus? And you're sitting there and eating popcorn. And all of a sudden, he starts telling you about his encounter with Christ on the road to Damascus. And you're like, what? Yeah, I was a persecutor of the Jews, man. Man, I'd take them kids and them children right out of the home and persecute them. Man, I tried to kill them. By the way, I held Stephen's coat and watched him die. What? That was before Christ. Wow, Paul. Are you kidding me? No. That's what God did in my life. Can you imagine that conversation? Can you imagine the conversation? By the way, that doesn't end for you, for me, guys. Aquila, Priscilla, gather close. I mean, after this, Christ revealed himself to me and separated me for a couple years and said that he was going to send me unto the Gentiles. What? Yeah, he's going to make me an apostle unto the Gentiles. Are you kidding? Yeah, God spoke to me directly through his son. I got a revelation. It was a mystery hidden in God, but he revealed it unto me. I'm revealing it unto you. What? Can you imagine those conversations? Can you imagine Paul saying, oh, by the way, it was just a little while ago. I was in prison. Wow, what kind of guy should we lock our doors when we go to bed at night? Who's this guy we got in the house? This guy was a murderer. This guy drugged people out of their homes. He just got out of jail. Yeah, God delivered me. You know, I was preaching the gospel over there like I am here and found myself before a false jury. They lied about me. And they lied about my friend Silas. But you know what we did? What, Paul? I bet they were sitting on the edge of their chair. We just started praying and praising. And you won't believe what happened. What? The angels rocked the jailhouse. It shook the ground, man. And you know what else? What? Tell us. The doors of the jail flew out open. Did you run? Oh, no, we stayed right there. And all the other guys did too. And you know what else? What? The chains and our shackles, our stocks, they broke off. Are you kidding me? No. And you know what else? What? The jailer got saved. And his house. What? Can you imagine Paul telling you that story? I bet he did. I bet he kept them up late at night. And I bet they wanted to hear it. But I can guarantee you that there were difficult times. Can you imagine the joy that might have flooded his soul as we get to verse 5, though? Because here's where we see the friends that come in just in time to encourage you. Can you imagine him working and probably thinking about, hey, you know, I've been teaching and preaching and no one responds to Jesus. And then it says, when Silas and Timothy were come from Macedonia, Paul was pressed in the spirit and testified to the Jews that Jesus was Christ. Can you imagine him being there, thinking about the day's events, thinking about what had happened and what hadn't happened, and here come Silas and Timothy, and they come to encourage him. And we read in Philippians 4:15, I'm not going to turn there, but we find that they brought a monetary gift to Paul. What an encouragement that is. Just when things aren't going that well, probably when he's discouraged in his heart. Man, Paul must have desperately needed this moral support. Say, how do you know? Because God sent him there. How do you know that? Look at verse 6 or verse 5. Look at the middle of verse 5. And when Silas and Timothy were come from Macedonia, Paul was pressed in the spirit. This fired Paul up. This encouraged him. See, why do you have to be fired up? You ever needed to be fired up? Encouraged? That means he was probably a little low. Maybe his tank was a little low. He just needed someone to come along and say, hey, you know what? Man, I know it looks tough. We remember what God's done, and we remember And we're believing that he'll do it again. And Paul, by the way, you remember that church, Macedonia? You remember Thessalonica? Yeah. I want you to know we haven't forgot you, but I also want you to know that church hasn't forgotten you either. And here's a little gift for you. Can you imagine what that did for his heart? Can you imagine how that encouraged him? The arrival of his friends was a wind to his sails. That phrase, pressed in the spirit, means to be compelled and driven. I believe it got him on the path again. I believe it encouraged him to go a little further. I believe it got him up the next morning with a little pep in his step, if you will. I don't know if you've ever been camping. I don't know if you've ever gotten a log cabin or a place in the mountain. But one of our favorite things to do when it gets cool is we like to go to the mountains and take a little reprieve. And one of the things that we often do is we try to always find a place. We do not go to any place that does not have a fireplace. But I'm going to tell you something about a fireplace. Now listen, folks, I'm not talking about that propane junk that you put natural gas right through. You just push a button and poof, there it is. I'm not talking about, I'm talking about the old-fashioned way. I'm talking about where you have to put another log on the fire. Here's what I have found about building a fire. You can let it burn, and that thing can get hot, and that thing can burn bright, and that thing can put out some heat, and boy, it just, doesn't it brighten your heart? Even on the coldest nights, you can edge up to that fire, and all of a sudden you feel comfortable. And you feel safe. Amen? But here's a thing I've learned about those fires. They have a tendency, if they're not maintained, to go out. But I have learned along the way, when I was growing up, we burned a lot of wood. My mother was even bit by a black widow spider that we used to bring wood into the house, and that wasn't real smart on our part at that time. We learned quickly, but we would keep it in the backyard, piled up and stacked. Really, it wasn't piled up. I had to cut it and stack it. All right, and then I had to bring it to the porch. That was the next run, and then you'd at least not have to go that far, and you'd go to the back porch. But then we got a little bit lazy, and like, you know what? Let's cut this trip a little bit shorter, and we put some in the house. And we believe one of those spiders came off those logs. But I remember growing up, when that thing would get where it looks like there's nothing but gray ashes in there, my dad would say, "Son, hey, I need you to go stoke." You know what stoke? You know that little jabber thing? I don't even know what that, what's that? I don't know what that iron thing is. That, what is that called? Poker. Oh, poker? Well, I don't play poker. I don't believe in poker. But You poke at it. You know, like Ernest T. Bass would say, you jab at it with that stick. You jab at it with that stick. And I'd look at that fire and I'd say, well, there's nothing there. He goes, oh, you go get that poker. You go get that iron. He says, you put some wood on there. And he says, and you stir it up a little bit. She'll catch fire. And you know what? He was right. And I'm saying to you that sometimes you need a poke. And God sent friends to the Apostle Paul to put that poker in there and stir that fire up again in him. He was pressed in the Spirit. Listen, if you have a Christian friend, if you have a friend at all who will pray for you, I want you to know you are a rich person. If you have somebody who will love you, if you have somebody that will be there for you, then you have something to thank God for, and you have something to see and look at as a blessing, even when the fire seems to go out. I thank God for that in our life. Can I give you another thing that I find very interesting? Would you look at verse 6? We see the blessings in difficult times that God always provides for our needs. He did for Paul. We see that he provides the encouragement at the right time. He did for Paul. But then notice verse 6. And when they opposed themselves and blasphemed. Now, he's teaching and he's bringing the gospel. And man, they are hating it. He shook his raiment unto them. And he says, your blood be upon your own hands. Your head, excuse me. I am clean. From henceforth, I will go unto the Gentiles. Now, this is amazing, because look at verse 7. And he departed thence and entered to a certain man's house named Justice, one that worshiped God, whose house joined hard to the synagogue. This story gets crazy. Look at verse 8. And Crispus, the chief ruler of the synagogue, believed on the Lord Jesus with all his house. And many of the Corinthians, hearing, believed that they were baptized. Then spake the Lord to Paul in the night by vision. Notice this. Here's what I want to get at. Be not afraid, but speak, and hold not thy peace. Verse 10, here it is. For I am with thee. Can we say that phrase, for I am with thee, all together, ready to begin? For I am with. Say it one more time. For I want you to know another blessing that I find even in difficult times is that no matter how hard it gets and no matter where I go, that God will continually be with me. His presence is always with us. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that good, loved one? As was typical, when Paul began to openly declare the gospel of Christ, there was great opposition. We just read that in verse 6. Paul openly denounced these Christ-rejecting Jews. He says, the blood be on your heads. No problem. And he declared that he was done, and I'm going to the Gentiles. Fine. You don't want to hear it? I'm going to break camp, and I'm going over here. Paul was fed up. You can imagine the frustration that he was going through. You can imagine that he was infuriated by the Jews when Paul began seeing numerous Gentile converts. You can imagine how hot they got. But apparently, Paul's life was threatened, and he was afraid for his life. Look at verse 8. And Crispus, the chief ruler of the synagogue, believed on the Lord Jesus Christ with the Lord, on the Lord with all his house. And many of the Corinthians hearing believed and were baptized. And the fact is, Paul left and moved on. And maybe perhaps when Paul was about to leave Corinth, there might have been a precious time for Paul when he needed this encouragement. I'm sure. But Paul was encouraged and was given complete assurance by God that no matter where he went, no matter what was happening, God says, I am with you. The end of verse 10, would you look at that? He says, and no man shall set on thee to hurt thee, for I have much people in this city. I wonder why he had to tell Paul that. I wonder why God has to remind you and me like this. I'm going to tell you why. Because oftentimes, in discouraging times, we put the sunglasses back on. And God is saying to you and me and to Paul, I need you to take those glasses back off because you're not seeing clearly. Paul, did you forget I just delivered you from jail? Now, how come you don't see Paul going, hey, I remember you delivering me, you'll deliver me here? How come Paul didn't go right to that and say that? How come you and I don't do that? I'll tell you why. We put the glasses back on. And we forget to see the blessings. Why? Because we're blinded by our own discouragement. And no matter how difficult things may get for the Christian on this sin-cursed earth, we have the blessed assurance that Jesus is ever with us. We can be thankful and we can see the blessing that we know that God will never leave us nor forsake us. Listen to me, loved one, and let me be clear. Don't you ever need to or have to pray for your pastor, God be with Pastor Larry, you don't have to pray that. God is with me all the time. No matter what surgery you go in, and I love praying that way. I love to be able to go and pray with people and say, hey, listen, I know you're about to go in surgery, but I want you to know in the operating room, I won't be there because I won't know what to do. And I don't want to look at all that stuff, all right? And so I'm not going to be in there, but I can promise you one who will be there, and that's Jesus Christ. He will always be there. And when you get in the recovery room, guess where? What? God will be there. And when you get to your room and you get to go home or whatever, guess what? God will be there. When you're in that car ride home, God will be there. God is always with you, loved one. Why? Because He indwells in you. The Bible says we are sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. Did you realize that? Do you know that tonight? That you can't do anything that will separate you from the love of God. So you don't even have to pray anymore. God be with me. God's like, I didn't know I went anywhere. I'm with you all the time. Now we may need to pray, God fill me. Because He may be with me, but that don't mean I'm letting Him live through me. Because sometimes we don't act Christ-filled, all right? But I want you to know by the assurance of God's word, God gave us His very Spirit, and He is with us until the day of redemption. The world, listen, can take everything away in our lives, but they cannot take God's presence from you. I want you to remember that. Say, oh, Pastor Larry, America's gone downhill, and we're going to live under a dictatorship. Well, you just loosen the neck, the tie around your neck a little bit. Calm down. It doesn't matter what our government will do or won't do. I just want you to know that they can take the religious exemption status. They can shut down every church. They can remove the Bibles from every hospital, every church. They can come in your home and try to remove it from your home. I just want you to know that they can't take God's word out of my heart. Isn't that encouraging? So I'm not going to worry about all that. That's not my focus. But I'll tell you what your focus could be and should be, and I'm going to close with this tonight. Look at your Bibles in Hebrews 13. Hebrews 13. Hebrews 13. Look at this with me. Bible says in verse 5 and 6. I don't know if the Apostle Paul wrote Hebrews. No one knows who the writer of Hebrews is. Some have speculated. I don't know if Paul wrote the book, but I do believe that a lot of the language and verb or grammatical construction is a lot alike Paul's writings. And so if Paul didn't write all of Hebrews or some of it, it looks like he may have had strong influence with it or in it or knew the person who did. And so I don't know that, and a lot of people comment on it. They don't know either because the Bible doesn't say. But I want this to encourage you. Look at Hebrews 13, verses 5 and 6. Let your conversation, this means your manner of lifestyle, how you live. Let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as you have. For He hath said, talking about Christ now, I will never leave thee, nor forsake thee. Verse 6, so that we may boldly say, that means say it with confidence, say it with assurance, say it with no doubting. What is that? The Lord is my helper, and I will not fear what man shall do unto me. Wow, what a blessing that is, that God's presence is always with us. He's my helper. You ever felt like you didn't have any help? Well, if I could just get someone to help me on this. Boy, we can fill in the blank. If I could just, you know what God's saying? Let me be a help to you. I am with you I will always be with you. I want to be an encouragement to you along the way. And so I hope that you will remember the blessings, even in difficult times. Number one, remember that God will always provide for you. Number two, He will put people in your life to encourage you along the way. And number three, from the context, and this isn't all of it, I'll get more to it next time, and that God's presence is always with you. Folks, that's some blessings that you can count on. That's an encouragement to get you through the week. I hope that'll be a help to you in the week to come. Let's pray. Father, we love you. Thank you for our time of the study. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the encouragement that we find from you. Thank you for loving us, being encouraging to us, and never letting us down. God, thank you for, even in difficult times, that we find that there are blessings and encouragement along the way. Thank you for the Apostle Paul, how much he must have endured, but what we get to see can be such a help to us in our life. If we will just learn of it and heed it, and Lord, and find encouragement from it. Lord, I thank you for the promises that we see in the Scripture. You are always with us. We don't need to pray, God, be with us. You are always with us. Lord, I thank you that you have promised to provide for my need. It's the content problem that we all have. And that's why we get dissatisfied. And God, thank you for people in our path and a long life's journey that come along and encourage us. The Apostle Paul sure needed it. And God just sent it at the right time. Thank you for knowing what he needed. Thank you for knowing what we need. God, you always know what's best. And we thank you for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. I hope that